In this video, I wanted to expand a little more on the engineer dropout problem. And if you are not aware of a video that I made a little while ago where it talks about why students leave engineering, and that was based on a study from the University of Washington more like 10 years ago. I think it was in 2007. But anyway, and in that study, they were basically mentioning how students leave engineering because they may not have a support group per se, or maybe financial reasons also make them leave engineering. Also because bottom line is that classes are too hard. And so in this video, I actually have this really cool 3-minute, very short, just stay with me here for a second, very short clip from CNN about 9 years ago, where they made this video on how there is a problem with the people that go to engineering school and they end up dropping out. And they're going to go over the reasons why that happens. And so I am going to give you my thoughts and my perspective as we go through this video. But first, if you are new to the channel, welcome. My name is Alex Isidro, and here we talk about engineering career and life analysis. And this is one of the videos where I actually walk you through my thought process and then react to something that I find interesting, not only that, but also something that you are going to get something out of. And the reason I wanted to make this video as well is also because I think that when you are aware of the potential barriers and the obstacles that you will be facing once you enter engineering school or later on in engineering school, then you will be a little more prepared. You will expect to find obstacles. You will expect to find barriers. You will expect to find difficulties. And when you know that, you're going to be a little more prepared mentally. And then once you go through those difficulties and the challenges, you're going to say, oh, okay, I knew this was coming. Like, and so I'm ready. So that way you're not blindsided and just expect everything to be easy and that you're not going to put in any work, you know, so that way you can like take matters into your own hand, focus on what you can control, and then go forward and go kill it in the major. So let's watch the video together, and then I am going to comment as we go along. So let's watch it right now.
These machines are moving more than dirt. They're moving jobs too. And entry-level engineers here rake in $65,000 a year. Companies from Caterpillar to Google are on the hunt for engineers.
You were an engineering major here.
Yes.
And then what?
I was struggling in the program, so I decided to study something different. And right now, I'm majoring in public relations and advertising.
That's actually very common. You know, if you are not in a school yet and you're just getting into engineering school, or you're thinking about it, it's pretty common to see people go from engineering either to an easier engineering field. One thing that was very common, at least in Virginia Tech, which is where I went to school, it was very common to see people go from mechanical or electrical engineering to industrial systems engineering, or they will go to business or communication or other easier majors per se. One reason is obviously that it's easier, right? Duh. But there's another reason why, and we're gonna go over that in a few seconds, so let's keep watching.
Here at the City College of New York, only 35% of students who enter the engineering school graduate as engineers.
Wow, that's a 65% dropout rate. That's crazy. That's, man, I don't know if that's on the students for not putting enough effort into the major, or that's on the professors and the level of education that this school is providing. You know, I don't know. It's 65% dropout. That's a lot, man. Woo!
With 9% unemployment and companies desperate to hire engineers, you'd think undergrads would be lining up to major in the sciences.
Hey, you know why? One of the reasons why you don't have many people lining up in the STEM fields is because it's difficult. It doesn't seem glamorous, like the lifestyle. You don't see the Lambos. You don't see the people throwing the money. You don't see engineers partying and going crazy and, you know, like pool parties, like all the stuff that you see on TikTok or all the glamorous stuff that you see on Instagram. Yeah, you don't really relate that to STEM fields. And not only that, but it's also very, very difficult to go and actually be successful in any STEM field, for instance, and or in engineering, right? In this case, in our case. And so, yeah, people shy away from that. People do shy away from things that are difficult, but not you, man. I know that you are going to go out there and you're going to kill it. So let's keep watching.
But few are, and many who do are quitting them.
I needed to raise my GPA to stay in the school, and that's what I did. So I left.
That's actually a really great point that I want to expand on a little bit. In the University of Washington study that I mentioned a few seconds ago, one of the reasons why people quit engineering was because many times, let's say they have scholarships, you know, and scholarships or schools, in the case of this gentleman, they have GPA requirements, they have grade requirements, and if you fall under that certain GPA, then you are going to run into trouble, you may get expelled, they may kick you out of a program or of a scholarship. And so what do people do? Because it's very, very difficult, once you start with the wrong foot in engineering, it can be very, very difficult to bring your grades back up, especially when you're like in your third, fourth semester, you know? And so what happens is that instead of keep trying even harder to bring those engineering grades up, people just opt for changing to a major that is much easier, where they can go and put in the same level of effort and get an A as opposed to a C or a D if it came to engineering. You know, so they transition to other majors because it's going to be easier and it's going to help them raise their grade so that they can keep their scholarships or stay in school for that matter.
Alina Savanska has dreamed of being a scientist since she was a young girl.
About two-thirds drop out. That was actually my experience with my friends.
Two-thirds dropout. That's, remember a few seconds ago, we talked about a 65% dropout. Now, two-thirds, like 66%, woo, that's a lot.
Three of us started together as freshmen, two of them switch out of the major.
But City College isn't alone. It's a national phenomenon. 22% of students choose a STEM major, that's science, technology, engineering, or math, at some point in their college career. But only 14% finish school in a STEM major.
After the just finishing the assignments, you have to put in extra work, so it's like maybe 8 hours a day extra.
Outside of the classroom.
Yeah.
I think that.
Yeah, I mean, that's pretty common, you know, in engineering. I want to say, I mean, how many of us have ever pulled all-nighters? And if you're thinking about going into engineering, I mean, unless you are really good with time management, you know, that's the key. Like, people that pull all-nighters, I want to say, generally speaking, either they have too much going on or the time management is not efficient. Mine wasn't efficient and they had too much going on. And so a lot of times, to be completely honest with you, sometimes I would rather go out and maybe go to dinner with a friend or like go out partying, and I would have to pull all-nighters. Yes, you're going to have to be putting in a lot of work when it comes to your engineering work. And so don't expect it to just be a walk in the park, because most likely it won't be.
And a lot of students don't realize how much work is required to really become an engineer. Academicians and professors can do also a better job of making the case that this is something that you want to do.
Programs where students build things like human-powered vehicles are part of the school's efforts to keep them from abandoning the major.
The idea is to make it go fast, also transport cargo.
But many say they enter college ill-prepared.
In high school, I took a lot of calculus and physics and chemistry courses, so it was something I was interested in. And throughout my first couple semesters, I was struggling with the math and sciences.
Yeah, so I think that one of the best things that you can do to prepare for engineering school, of course, depending on what type of engineering field you're going to get into, at least for mechanical engineers, like definitely calculus and physics. Like, those two are going to be extremely, extremely beneficial when it comes to your college journey. Now, of course, if you're going to be a software person or computer science person, obviously you're going to have to take some coding and whatnot. But generally speaking, I think that there are some classes that you can take that are going to prepare you for your engineering classes when you go to university.
But here at Columbia, 96% of students that enter engineering graduate as engineers.
96%. That's actually very good. And I think it's a little cruel for this reporter to compare Columbia, which is an Ivy League, with another engineering school that I never even heard of personally. So you go from a school that has a 65% dropout to another one that has a 4% dropout. Wow. It's a little cruel to make that huge difference. You know, it's like a comparison. I mean, wow. Woo!
The engineering dean at Columbia University attributes its success to a more practical approach.
When you go to school and all you see is differential equations and you don't see the application of that differential equation or the Fourier transform into a real application of a bridge or a building, you start losing interest. We try to keep them engaged on seeing their application, both from the impacts to society that they can make and well as their own satisfaction.
I want to work in the nuclear industry.
Why spend so much time studying? Is it worth it?
It is worth it.
Why?
Because you become more well-rounded. You look at the world differently.
That's actually a really good point. I think that when you learn these hard classes, when you go through these tough subjects, you know, anything in engineering or science and technology and math, you take all these classes, they help you rewire your brain in such a way that it really helps you be a better problem solver. And it helps you also be a little more creative and approach a problem in different ways, not just doing the same thing all the time, or trying to approach a problem the same way multiple times and just expecting a different result, you know? And then also the last thing I want to mention here with respect to this video, and something that I want you to keep track of, is how it's really good to keep engineers engaged ever since starting from their first year. I think that also helps them visualize what they're learning. And I think that that's one of the reasons why physics labs are very, very, not just physics labs, but like labs in general are very, very crucial to helping students or young people understand what they're working on and apply all the theory they're learning and help them visualize everything that some things or the theories could be in the real world and real world applications. And so, of course, that's just one way, and there are many other ways you can make that happen. So I hope you are actually ready for the road ahead, and just be aware that engineering is difficult, but don't shy away from it. Take it one step at a time. And I've said this multiple times in the past on how it's about going one step at a time and then just not shying away from those huge complex formulas that you see a lot of professors fill out blackboards and whiteboards and all these like crazy memes that you see, you know, because that's something that you may be dealing with or that you will be dealing with at some point in your student journey or even professional career, but you're not getting there from day one. You're not going to get there on day one. That's something that you do on your third, fourth year, and that it's like a slow process, like a slow cooking process, right? You are introduced to different theorems, to different hypotheses, different applications and math classes and different concepts. And throughout the years, you start learning more and more. And before you know it, the equations that you are dealing with are so long and complex that sometimes you are even amazed by how you can understand those concepts or how you can actually understand everything that is going on. When somebody that is an outsider and then takes a look at your book or your notes, you're like, what the hell is happening here? Like, it's just very intimidating, right? So I just wanted to bring that up to your attention and give you that insight so that you can be prepared of what's coming up ahead.